Welcome to my studio. I'm Ms. Devlin, and I'm going to give you a class in turning ideas into forms. Ideas, music, text, words, how do you translate those into pieces of cardboard, into three-dimensional forms? What's the process? What are the processes that you might use, that you could learn? And on this table are relics and traces of a train of thought that's been going on in this room, usually with a whole bunch of people who are helping me, and somewhat in my mind for 25 years. And these are kind of the relics of it, the traces of it. This is a maze, which became a large-scale installation called Mirror Maze in 2016. This is a much earlier version of this maze. This one, this model was made in 2005, and this particular maze was never realized. But without the train of thought that led to these particular bits of cardboard being put where they are, that later mirror maze piece wouldn't have happened. This was another iteration along the way. Often there are many, many iterations, many, many versions of just trying things out, exploring thoughts through forms, revolving cube, revolving kinetic sculpture, which has led to a lot of experiments in stage sculptures. This one, a revolving house. This one helped tell the story of the hunt at the Almeida Theatre last year. Maps, layers of paper, exploring how many dimensions a map can have. Eventually that became a large installation called Memory Palace. Portraits. The Weekend, Abel Tesfaye. This one led to a train of thought that finally found its way onto the Coachella Festival stage a few years ago. And this is Adele in 2015. Large crowds of people singing along with a singing portrait. And what I'm going to do today is teach you some processes that I use just to help translate something that's abstract into something that's concrete. Some processes that you can use. And all you're gonna need is paper and scissors. The process always begins for me with paper, pencil, and research. So in this case, I'm picking up a train of thought that I've been having for some time. It's a purely instinctive piece of pattern making, piece of connection between the branching forms of trees and the branching forms that we find in so many other parts of nature and parts of human construction. For a few years, I've been drawing trees and noticing that they look like bronchial structures. I've been tracing over X-ray images of bronchial structures and noticing that they look a bit like trees. And I've been reading James Gleick's 1987 book, Chaos, and trying to really understand the maths that links lungs and trees, as well as myriad other processes at work inside us and around us. allow your research to take you as far as you want. Allow one thought to lead to another. Don't be afraid to go down a rabbit hole of research. Permit yourself to let the smallest, most tenuous hook of connection lead you from one piece of research to another. But what I would say is, like Hansel and Gretel in the forest, leave breadcrumbs, leave traces of your train of thought, because then you can pick along those traces later. Otherwise, it somehow can be a little bit hard to really remember what the joints and the junctions were between one thought and the next. And to me, that's the really interesting part. Find the common denominators, find the patterns, find the underlying patterns, and just follow them intuitively. Nature forms patterns. Some are orderly in space, but disorderly in time. Others orderly in time, but disorderly in space. My mother once said to me, if every time you look at a bunch of sunflowers, you are reminded of the painting that Van Gogh did of the sunflowers, then he has done his job as an artist. If an artist makes you reflect on something that's in your everyday life, then that was a piece of art worth making. So the purpose of this particular exercise would be to try to invite people to think differently about lungs, about the bronchial structures, the respiratory tree that we each carry around with us. We carry these two trees. And likewise, if the stomata within every leaf on every tree weren't carrying out the beautiful mechanics that they carry out every day to release and ingest oxygen and carbon dioxide, then the air wouldn't be breathable. Gradually, I find my way into a type of maze. Mazes are something that I've been exploring for a while. And this is the sketch that kind of emerges. And I've been working on a large-scale maze sculpture based on the geometry that connects the internal and external structures that allow us to breathe. So in this sketch, what my team have begun to do is to imagine that sketch turned into a maze structure. This gives a sense of how it might look inside that maze, full of people. What I've been imagining is that visitors will walk through a maze that follows the lines of a bronchial structure, and they'll discover annotated reflections of themselves, highlighting the tree-like structures within their own lungs. It'll kind of make physical, sort of gamify, make memorable the connection between the geometry of human lungs and the trees which allow the lungs to function. I have to say though that right now, human lungs feel like a territory under siege. I'm trying to re-understand them. This exquisite structure, actually, two intertwining trees and veins and arteries, is far from exceptional. The body is filled with such complexity. Typical human lungs pack in a surface area bigger than a tennis court. As an added complication, the labyrinth of windpipes must merge efficiently with the arteries and veins. Often the traces that are left by my research are the thing that really stays with me. You know, the piece that one makes has to be seen as the tip of the iceberg of the research that went into it. It's like when you used to do a maths exam and the teacher would always say, just show your workings, because it might be something in your workings that's really the thing to hold on to. Let the research expand as far as you can. Put no holds on it at all. So allow that.
to take you as far in any direction and in multiple directions. Then you need to set, I think, some rules and say, okay, well, what if it can only be white? Okay, just for a minute, because form and color, operating different parts of our eyes, rods and cones, it's a lot to take on at once. What if we're only dealing in form, just form, right? And what if the forms that we're going to deal with can only be cut out of pieces of A4 paper? And what if we set ourselves one more parameter, which is the use of a box, a frame? I like working with frames with a bit of depth. I'm really interested in when is something two-dimensional and when is it three-dimensional? And I do think also this particular proportion, an A4 piece of paper, is pretty interesting because we deal with it all day long. A4 paper comes in and out of our lives. And it's also a similar proportion to the screen that you are watching me through now and the screens that are dominating our lives, particularly in this lockdown moment, but all of the time. Now, you might have been drawing something completely different to me. Your concern might be with formations and patterns that have nothing to do with this. It doesn't matter. Whatever you've been drawing, I would say force yourself to draw and iterate on at least 40 sheets of paper. Don't stop until you've iterated. You have to, iteration is sometimes about boring yourself. Just keep drawing until you bore yourself into drawing something interesting. Draw the same thing 40 times, but force yourself to make it a little bit different every time. Force yourself to move it on and ask yourself the question, how did this sketch move my thinking on? Because the sketches are a trace of your thought. Then you have them out in front of you. Surround yourself. So you kind of, I find it easier to unfold my mind, to unfold what I've been thinking, to spread it out around me like a map. I like to make a big chart of it, kind of like a piece of music of it. So it's charted and I can see the whole flow of it. So I want to see the flow of this train of thought. And then set yourself a parameter and say, okay, well, how many of these am I going to make? And that's when you can just have some fun. You can put some secret intelligence, underlying intelligence into the work that you make. It doesn't matter if no one else is going to know this piece of information except you and anyone you whisper it to. It's like sewing secrets into the hems of clothing. You can just stitch little pieces of secret information. So for example, I'm thinking about quarantine. I'm thinking about the origins of the word. The word quarantine came from the Italian quaranta, because in the days of the plague, goods and people had to wait 40 days outside the city of Venice. Obviously the number 40 is significant in so many ways culturally. 40 days in the wilderness, 40 days in the desert. So, could make 40 of these, but I think I'm gonna make 5, and the little personal secret I'm gonna stitch into them is this is 8 centimeters deep. And 5 times 8 is 40, and that's good enough for me. The next stage then is to think, how am I gonna take this train of thought and translate it into a sequence of 5? Patterns are often seen not just in space, but in time. And sometimes the scale at which they reveal themselves in time is a scale that we as humans are not used to tuning into. So take 5 of these and just do a little plan in your head, a little map of the piece you're gonna make. You can break the rules of the map afterwards. You can change your mind, but I would map it out. So map out, say, right, well, I've got 5 of these and I've been sketching, I've found some forms, what might fit? Again, working at different speeds of work. So the initial speed of your research can be very, very fast. You know, very quickly get 3 pages in and then flick to another thing. As soon as the thought makes a connection, every time you make a new cognitive connection, then leap, and map your leaps as you go. So that's very fast. And then the sketching can be very fast as well, the initial sketching. They're not sketches to be finished. You don't get tight, you don't get stuck on them. They are there literally just to record your train of thought. They should be as fast as thought. I can often, when I look at my own sketches, I can tell, was it a thinking sketch or, you know, was it a sketch where the thought was already complete? And I love the energy of the thinking sketches because I can just see, this was the sketch where I actually had an idea. That's kind of the last piece of fast work in a way. After this, you've reached the end of a breath. This whole process was a piece of music. You reach the end of the first movement. Now you're into the next movement, which is slower, and where your mind doesn't have to be quite so fully concentrated on ideating. Now you'll go into a slight zone where a lot of the thinking will go on in your fingertips now. So, taking what you've drawn, and again, you don't have to follow it slavishly, but you're now thinking with your fingers, thinking with your hands. Now you're figuring out, when do you puncture through from a two-dimensional surface down into the depth of this box? And in this case, I'm working with a flowing drawing, and I'm now taking the drawing from a two-dimensional set of lines into an exploration of three-dimensional space. And I like the tension between the limitless aspect of the research. Research can take you anywhere, but in the presentation of the work, there are some quite clear constraints that force you to really make decisions. What about all those thoughts that you've just had? What about all that train of ideation that you just went through? What's really important to you? And you make that decision about what's important and what's most salient and what's most emotionally resonant with you. You make that decision not so much with your mind, but with your fingers, with your hands. And when it's really flowing and when it's really working, a conversation begins between your eyes and your hands that seems to bypass your brain. What's beautiful about making anything with your hands is when you go back and look at that work, you remember the thoughts that are encased within each decision that you made. I sometimes look at work that I made when I was very young, and I can remember conversations that I was having, or radio programs that I was listening to, or pieces of music that I was listening to while I was making the work. So again, this is not so much an end in itself, but a recording process. It is more of those crumbs that you're leaving to remind yourself later, when you look back at this piece, who you were when you made it and how you've changed since you made it. And that couldn't be more useful, I think, than now when we have this space. We have reached a crossroads. We've emerged from what we assumed was normality. Things have suddenly overturned. One of our main tasks now, especially for those of us who are not sick, and are not frontline workers, and are not dealing with other economic or housing difficulties, is to understand this moment, what it might require of us, and what it might make possible. When a caterpillar enters its chrysalis, it dissolves itself, quite literally, into liquid. In this state, what was a caterpillar and will be a butterfly is neither one nor the other. It's a sort of living soup. Within this living soup are the imaginal cells that will catalyze its transformation into winged maturity. May the best among us, the most visionary, the most inclusive, be the imaginal cells. We are both becalmed and in a state of profound change. Every stage of this process that I'm showing you now normally takes place as part of a conversation between me and many collaborators, the team in this room, teams around the world. And for this time, it's just me. There was a wonderful quote somebody said recently, someone said a long time ago, it was quoted recently, never let a crisis go to waste. So I am relishing this time on my own in the studio, this period.
Apparently Shakespeare worked in quarantine much of the time during the plague years of the 17th century. Seems he turned to writing poetry while the theatres were closed. And he may have written these lines during the plague year of 1609. That time of year thou mayest in me behold, when yellow leaves, or none, or few, do hang upon those boughs which shake against the cold, bare, ruined choirs where late the sweet birds sang. Also, I've been thinking a fair amount about working with paper. So there's many traditions of this, obviously wonderful traditions of paper cut, origami paper folding, of intricate, beautiful paper cuts. The internet is full of exquisite, there are whole collectives making really exquisite work, you can see.
And I'm thinking of artists like Picasso and Matisse. Matisse, I think particularly while he was ill, made paper cuts from his bed. And there's something about the intrinsic properties of a piece of paper. I mean, this paper that I'm using is actually 180 grams per square meter, which is slightly heavier than a normal piece of photocopier paper or printing paper, but you can use any paper. But something about a piece of paper this size, it behaves in a way that allows you to create an architecture without too much thought about how the architecture is going to hold itself up. It's very forgiving. Something about the proportion of the ratio of the weight versus the size. So it will hold its own. You don't have to stop and think, how am I going to stick this together, right? You instead can not interrupt the flow of thought because the paper will hold the bend that you persuade into it and it'll take the molding just with your thumb. You don't have to work too hard to cut it. You can tear it if you like and create beautiful organic edges to it as well. You can hold it just with a pin and a little piece of glue. So work with that, work with the ease of a piece of paper. Clouds are not spheres, mountains are not cones, lightning does not travel in a straight line. The new geometry mirrors a universe that is rough, not rounded, scabrous, not smooth. It's a geometry of the pitted, pocked, and broken up, the twisted, tangled, and intertwined.
There were forms in nature. Not visible forms, but shapes, inherent in the fabric of motion, waiting to be revealed. What began as a train of thought, a train of inquiry, a treasure hunt, made static into this group of five frames from that train of thought. Now with lights, I can layer the motion back in. I can bring the flow back to life. And now if you start projecting another two-dimensional surface and seeing how it lands on those three dimensions, for me there are many mesmerizing possibilities in the interplay between moving projected image and surface and depth in form. And I suggest just play as the light goes down in my studio at the end of this day. I am just going to spend some time playing. And actually some of the things I now start to play with and start to project on this, I'm just literally flicking through a video library. And I'm back in that research mode that I was at the beginning of the day. Let me try this. Oh, what did that make me think of? So I'm thinking about veins, and then I'm thinking about blood, and then I'm thinking about leaves, and I'm thinking about forests. Now I'm thinking about wind, and I'm thinking about hurricanes. Now I'm thinking about people, about crowds. The crowds that I hope will one day populate it. I hope one day that this piece will be realized into the large-scale maze that I have in the back of my mind. I hope so. I hope it will one day be populated again with people. I hope some of the other works that we're conceiving in the studio will be populated with people singing together collectively, with choirs, those bare ruined choirs where late the sweet birds sang. Can't get that phrase out of my head, those bare ruined choirs where late the sweet birds sang. That's how this room feels to me at the moment.